At all. We are in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. And when you look at verse 1, it's very important. When we look at verse 1, it is talking up concerning now concerning spiritual. Okay, the word gift is in italics, meaning it was not there in the original manuscript, but it's there for the purposes of us understanding. Now concerning the spiritual, The word spiritual here can stand for two things. Can stand for the people who are indwelt by the Holy Spirit, or stand for the gifts, or the things of the Spirit, I'm reading King James Version, but okay. Let's look at the Amplified. Now, about the spiritual gifts. The special endowment of supernatural energy. Brethren, I do not want you to be misinformed. We are not supposed to be misinformed or to be ignorant. We are supposed to be knowing. The things of the Spirit, pneumaticos, the things of the Spirit, in Greek, pneumaticos. We are supposed to be knowing them. These things of the Spirit that have been deposited in us. We are supposed to be knowing them. And as we know them, we are not supposed to be misinformed. We are supposed to be informed. We are supposed to know clearly what is in us, how it works, So when we are looking at these things of the Spirit or the spirituals, the pneumaticals, we are not supposed to be misinformed. We are supposed to be a people filled with the Holy Spirit, and because He fills us, we are supposed to be knowing the things that the Spirit of God deposits in us. And those things that the Holy Spirit deposits in us is what we are calling gifts, the things that He has given to us, or the spirituals that He has deposited in our lives. And those are the things that we are looking at. Calling them spiritual gifts, because they are given by the Holy Spirit, according to verse 4. They are given by the Holy Spirit. So we will look at this. And let's look at the spiritual gifts. We are dealing with the classes, or classifications of the spiritual gifts. And when we talk about spiritual gifts in Greek, it is charismata, That's what the gifts of the Spirit are called in Greek. And I'm not talking about Greek, the way sometimes we talk in a mother tongue and we call it Greek. No, I'm talking about the original Greek. The Greek as language, not our mother tongue. Don't think that this is a Kikuyu term. No, this is a Greek term. You know, nowadays when people talk in their vernacular, they say that that is Greek. No, it's not. Now I'm talking about Greek itself. Charismata, spiritual gifts. It is charismata. And when we talk about this word charismata, you find these are two words, charis and should we go that direction? Okay. Charis simply means grace. Matikos means gifts. So these are gifts that are given by grace. You cannot buy them. You cannot earn them. They are not received by merit. They are received by grace. They are received by grace. That is the word charis. Charis means grace. Matiko means gifts. So grace gifts. And now, because they are given by the Holy Spirit, we call them charis mata. Charis mata. And when we are looking, and this is where also we get the word charisma. Oh, that person is full of charisma. You know, the way people say, oh, he's full of charisma. They simply mean that the person is endued. Endued with energy, endued with power, endued with gifts, endued with a certain gift that people recognize. But let's stick to what we are supposed to look at. This text in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, it is speaking to us about the spiritual gifts. And these spiritual gifts are capacities. Are capacities given freely to us by the Holy Spirit. It is not something that we were born with. It is something that the Holy Spirit has deposited in us. A certain energy, a certain charisma, so that we may be able to excel in that area more than anybody else. So it is something given to us by the Holy Spirit. We will look at these spiritual things one by one. But we need to understand that by the virtue of the word charis and the word gifts, there are things that we cannot buy. There are things that we cannot buy. There are things that we cannot earn because of either being good or because of doing certain things, we can't handle them. They are given by grace as the Holy Spirit chooses. As the Holy Spirit chooses or decides. And these are contained in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 8 to verse 10. Chapter 12, verse 8 to verse 10. They operate through a spirit-filled person. They operate through a spirit-filled person. They operate through a spirit-filled person. That's why in verse 28 of the same 1 Corinthians chapter 12, please help us with verse 28 of 1 Corinthians chapter 12. These are the people. And that's why we talked about spiritual, concerning the spiritual, the gifts and those who are indwelt by those gifts. So God has appointed some in the church for his own use. First apostles, special messengers, second prophets, inspired preachers and expounders of God's word, obvious. Third, teachers, then wonder workers, then those with ability to heal the sick, helpers, administrators, that is speakers in different and known tongues. You see, these are now the people. These are now the people who can be called, without Greek word, the pneumaticals. The pneumaticals. People who are indwelt by the gift of the Holy Spirit. So the gift operates through the people who are filled by the Holy Spirit. The gifts don't operate in people who are not born again. The gifts operate with those who are born again. And these gifts are not talents, as we will see. They are not talents. You may have been born with a talent. You may have developed a talent in you. Like yesterday, everybody, maybe you came expecting that today we'll be talking about breaking the limits because of, and you are not limited. And who are your pace setters? We came to talk about the Holy Spirit. And you see, yesterday somebody who has developed and worked on their talent stand in the world. And that person happens to be a Kenyan. Amen. And we thank God for blessing us. We are releasing influence in every field. Amen. But we are talking about people who are indwelt by the Holy Spirit. People who are indwelt by the Holy Spirit. They are the ones that the Holy Spirit operates, these gifts operate through them. Not carnal people. Not carnal people. And we see the people mentioned in verse 28 of 1 Corinthians chapter 12. These gifts originate from the Holy Spirit. That's why they are not talents. They originate from the Holy Spirit. They are divinely given. They have a divine origin. They have a divine origin because the Holy Spirit is God. They are not merited. They are not earned. They are not bought. They originate from the Holy Spirit and operate through us who are spirit-filled. Every one of us has a certain gift. We may not know it. We may not be aware of it now. But we can seek the Lord to help us know the spirit or the gift that dwells in us. And as we say it, in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, the purpose of us seeking to know the gifts and using the gifts should be love. Love should be the motivation for us to operate in these gifts. That whatever we will do in the service or as these gifts operate, the motivation should be love. If the motivation is not love, then what did we say? Whatever we do is nothing, we gain nothing, and we profit nothing. So it is very, very important. As we look at these gifts that are working within us, we should know that when we are operating in these gifts, our motivation should not be money. Our motivation should not be fame. Our motivation should not be money. Our motivation should not be that we be known, but that Christ should be glorified. That is why the Holy Spirit is depositing these gifts. These gifts. As we talked about the fruit, when it's operating, the motivation is love. Also, the gifts, when they are operating, the motivation is God's love. So that God's love can be revealed to God's people. We look at the first class of the gifts. Let's look at the first class of the gifts of the Spirit or the charismata. The first gifts or the first class of the gifts. They are called revelational gifts. Revelational gifts. And we say these gifts are the word of wisdom, the word of knowledge, and the discerning of spirits. The word of wisdom, the word of knowledge, and the discerning of spirits. Why are they called revelational gifts? or mind gift. Why are they called revelational gifts or mind gift? I know, especially many of us in the charismatic church, the church that is full of strength and power and energy, and the gifts that are operating, or the evangelicals. When we talk about these gifts, what comes into our minds is the spontaneous knowledge of something that we did not know, or spontaneous word that we know by the Spirit. It is more than that. These gifts are more than just knowing something spontaneously. Yes, that is there. Especially you come in and by the grace of God, I'm able to know everything about you as the Spirit reveals. Spontaneously. I had not been told before. No one has revealed or shared with me about what you're going through, about what. And then I start telling you. That is spontaneous. But these gifts, their work is more than that. I know that's what we know. Either somebody wants something done and you have a certain wisdom, a certain knowledge of how that thing should be done and done quickly, and you help that person spontaneously. That's what we know. But that is just the beginning. We need to get deeper. We need to get deeper into these gifts so that we do not only operate superficially. We know that they operate deeper than just that spontaneous knowledge. So they are, these gifts are called revelational gifts because you know supernaturally. You know supernaturally. Not something you have been taught, not something that you've been told before, but through the revelation of the Holy Spirit, you are able to know. You are able to know, or you are able to give a certain word of knowledge to be applied in a given situation. I hope I'm not moving too fast. So that we may be able to grasp and understand. So they are revelational gifts because through them, we are able to know supernaturally as we receive divine illumination. So the knowledge that we get, the wisdom that we pronounce, it is illuminated to us by the Holy Spirit. It is by divine illumination. We talked about divine illumination as we were looking at the fruits of the Spirit. So the Holy Spirit sheds light on something and gives you knowledge supernaturally. It is not a knowledge that you acquire in class. It is not somebody who has told you. It is the Holy Spirit who reveals it to you. That's why they are called revelational gifts. Because you receive the revelation, the insight, the illumination from the Spirit of God Himself. They operate primarily in the realm of the intellectual or mind. That's where they operate, in the realm of the mind. So you are able to know. They operate in the realm of the mind, making them to be known as mind gifts. Because they operate in the realm of the mind, that makes them to be known as mind gifts. They are understanding gifts. They are understanding gifts. We will look at the word understanding as we continue. They are understanding gifts, which produce insight into revealed truth. They are understanding gifts which produce insight into revealed truth. Just pause there. What do you get by that? So, these gifts, their work is to give us understanding of a revealed truth. These gifts are not giving us the truth. The truth is already there. But they are giving us understanding, operating in the realm of the mind by the revelation of the Holy Spirit. We are able to understand the revealed truth. So the truth is already there. The truth is already there. These gifts are not giving us the truth. That's why we should not operate with a superficial understanding of these gifts, that they're just spontaneous receiving of knowledge, receiving of words, or receiving of something, knowing some facts. No, the truth is there. These gifts make us understand. They give us understanding of a revealed truth. The truth is there. The truth is already revealed. These gifts give us understanding. Gnosis. That is the word understanding. In Greek, gnosis. Understanding. So, they give us understanding of the revealed truth. He has given us. Knowledge is gnosios. Understanding is gnosis. So these gifts, please spare them before we get there. Otherwise, we'll start going ahead of ourselves. They give us understanding. They give us the ability to understand. The gifts give us the ability to understand the truth that is already revealed. The truth is existing. So we do not, the speaking of what is revealed is not what is called word of knowledge. The truth is already there. So you are not knowing now. When you are saying, it's not that the time the truth is there, or you are saying the truth is already existing. You just get the understanding by the gift. You get the understanding of the existing truth. We will give examples. As far, we are still defining. We are still giving the definition of these words in general, and then we'll look at them specifically. So they produce, the gifts produce insight into revealed truth, and which convey the mind of God or God's thoughts. Once the insight has been given, and you understand by the gift, you are able now to tell, to speak the mind of God or the thoughts of God concerning a particular person, concerning a particular situation. Are we together up to there? If you are not together, just say we are not together. We are together. So the work of this gift, the operation of this gift, that is operated by the Holy Spirit in the realm of our understanding, the insight is given that you understand. And once you understand, you are now able to speak the mind of God or God's thoughts concerning a person, concerning a situation. So it is not knowledge that you had before. It is not the time that you're speaking that is the time the truth is happening. The truth is already there. And you're just given insight to understand the truth that already exists so that you speak it as God sees it and as God says it. You see and you say. You speak the mind of God that has been revealed to you. These gifts are the word of wisdom, the word of knowledge, the discerning of spirits. So, they are the three of them. And they are not in order according to the way they have been brought forth in 1 Corinthians. That's why we are talking about the classes, the grouping, the classification of gifts. The gifts that operate in a similar way. They have been put together. When you read in the scripture, the discerning of spirits is almost the last one. But it is in this category of word of wisdom, word of knowledge, and the discerning of spirits, because there is a progression in their use and in their operation. There is a progression. There is a progression. You begin with one. That level leads you to another level, and that level builds on another level. For example, and we are going to write it down shortly, the word of wisdom does not come before the word of knowledge. The word of knowledge should come before. The word of knowledge should be before the word of wisdom. Why? Because wisdom is the knowledge being applied. That's why knowledge has to be first. And then wisdom, the revealed knowledge, you put it in action in the way that it helps, then it becomes wisdom. Knowledge, you put it in use in the way that it's supposed to operate, it becomes wisdom. We will deal with that. So the word of knowledge should come before the word of wisdom. And how will you be able to know which spirit is operating when the word is being spoken? It's through discernment. So these three work together. One leads to another. But we will come to define them shortly. So the three. And here we can give them their Greek words, the word of knowledge is known as, you have seen it, Logos Genesios. It is very helpful. Please don't just laugh. It is very helpful, especially for those who are students. It is going to be very helpful for you. But if you are not students, but just know, And this word logos, we know, just means word, logos. And then nosios means knowledge. But this is different from the word understanding. We will see later on. The second word is the word of wisdom. The gift of the word of wisdom. We are in a situation. We need wisdom. We need wisdom. And then the Lord just provides what we need at that time. The knowledge that we need to make use of for us to get out of that situation or to solve that problem. Logosophias. Plato. When you talk about Sophias, you just remember Plato, the philosopher. Pengine tutadili na yeye huyo Plato. And we will be able to see, especially when we are dealing with the gift of word of wisdom. Word of wisdom. We'll deal with that. We'll deal with what is philosophy and what is word of wisdom. Word of wisdom and philosophy, they are in contention. They fight. Because one is of God and the other one is human. We'll deal with that as we get to the definition and developing the word of knowledge. Then we have the last word, the discerning of spirits, a very difficult word. Diakari says, pneumaton, spirits. Diakari says, pneumaton. Okay, these are the three gifts that we will deal with, and they are called revelational gifts. Revelational gifts. They are there to help the body of Jesus Christ. They are there to help believers, whether as an individual or as a body of Christ. They are there for the benefit of us all. Whether an individual believer benefiting from the word that is pronounced, the mind of God for a particular situation, for a particular condition, for a particular circumstance, or all of us, the body of Jesus Christ, we need to get out of a particular situation, we need to get out of a particular issue. The word will come forth and will give us understanding of what we need to do for us to get out of what we are in or what we are facing or the problems that we are dealing with. There is a difference between the word of knowledge and the word of wisdom. There is a difference between knowledge and wisdom. And the difference is, the word of wisdom follows the word of knowledge. Because wisdom builds on knowledge. So they are not one and the same thing. That when I'm speaking, I'm both using knowledge and it's the same wisdom. No. Wisdom is built upon knowledge. Wisdom comes after knowledge. So the word of wisdom will build on the word of knowledge. But wisdom is superior to knowledge. Wisdom is superior to knowledge. So the gift of the word of wisdom is superior to the gift of word of knowledge. The gift of word of wisdom is superior to the gift of the word of knowledge, even though the word of knowledge comes before the word of wisdom. Let's look at the gifts individually. Let's look at these gifts individually. The first one is the word of knowledge. We start with the word of knowledge because it comes before the word of wisdom. Word of knowledge. Greek again is logos, gnoseos. Let's define word of knowledge. A word of knowledge is an utterance. Inspired by God, spoken by an individual. It is an insight into the things freely given to us by God. First Corinthians chapter 2 verse 12. Just write it as we continue with definition. It shares the truth the Spirit wishes to declare. Concerning a specific occasion. Concerning a specific occasion. It does not give a directive for action. Does not give the directive of action. Let's look at this definition before we continue. The word of knowledge, we are saying, is an utterance inspired by God. The utterance is inspired by the Holy Spirit. It is not something that we formulate. It is not something that we think or we have read somewhere that we are uttering. It is inspired by God. The utterance, what we are speaking, is inspired by God, but it is spoken by an individual. Inspired by God, spoken by an individual, which gives an insight into the things freely given to us by God. So you see, this takes us deeper than when I look at you and tell you yesterday you did not eat supper. It deals with some things that are deeper than that. It deals and gives us insight to the things that God has already given to us freely. 1 Corinthians chapter 2 verse 12. Please help us with that verse. It is going to help us to understand as we look into this. So it's not just standing there and seeing things and saying. It is deeper than that. It may start at looking at things and saying what we see, but it is deeper than that. It is deeper than that, because just seeing and saying, that is occasion. I've seen you, I've said what has happened to you or what you are going through, that is over. That is over. But it is supposed to benefit the body of Jesus Christ by seeing you and telling you that yesterday you did not eat supper. How does that benefit the body of Christ? How does that profit the body? So, those are the preliminaries. Those are the initial stages for the gift to operate. But it should go deeper. It should go deeper so that it can benefit the body of Jesus Christ. Now we have not received the Spirit that belongs to the world, but the Holy Spirit who is from God, given to us that we might realize and comprehend and appreciate the gifts of divine favor and blessing so freely and lavishly bestowed on us by God. Thus, this word of knowledge is supposed to know things that are freely given to us, gives us an insight. For example, discovering and finding out the gifts that you have, so that from now you start knowing that this is the gift that I have that God has deposited in me, and this is how it is supposed to operate. You begin to build and to develop on the gift that you have received. You begin to start the gift that you have received. Many of us, just like Paul says, that do not neglect the gift that was given to you. You know it. You know the gift that was given to you. Don't neglect it. How do you know? You know it by this word. You know the gift by the word. You know the gift by the word of knowledge. And this word of knowledge can come, can be inspired by God, and the person speaks and tells you, this is the gift that God has deposited in you. This is the gift that God has given to you. So that from there, you know the gift that is in you. That knowledge, that insight, to know the things that are freely given to us by God, it is what is known as the word of knowledge. But what has been happening in the church, in the body of Jesus Christ? We are just told, your neighbor on the left is... By you telling me my phone number, I already know it. Oh, your name is so-and-so, and your phone number is this. How does that? How does that benefit the body of Jesus Christ? Instead, tell me, you have been given this gift. From there, I will know what to do with the gift. And I know which gift operates. But I just, your number is this and this. And somebody has just been given papers that according to the way these people are seated. The first one, the phone number is this. The name and the phone number. Please, let's stop these games, these gimmicks. Don't help anybody. I tell you your phone number, I tell you where you live, and then I ask you your name. The Spirit that has revealed to me the phone number should reveal to me your name. We need God to help us. We need more serious things to operate by the word of knowledge than what is operating. We need to be taken deeper. We need to be told. The Lord is saying there will be a famine in this and this. We need that so that we can prepare, so that we can know in advance. Like what Elisha used to say to the king, King, take this word to the king that the king should not pass by that road tomorrow, because there will be people waiting, the Assyrians are waiting to kill him tomorrow. We need something that will help. Are you getting?
Yes.
We need something that will help. If this gift of word of knowledge is enough, we should seek the Lord deeper, and we should seek to know, and we should, because things are happening. We should be knowing before they happen. God has said that before things happen, he will reveal to his prophets. We need to be knowing there is an LED planted somewhere, and you are able to communicate in advance to those in relevant authorities that please let not our armies pass through there. Let not our police pass through there. There is an explosive electronic, there is an IED planted there. Improvised explosive device planted there. We need them. The nation of Israel was so blessed to have Elisha that when they are planning wars and planning to attack, Elisha is able to send the word. This is the level that we should seek and desire the gift of the word of knowledge to operate in. Not telling you who is cursing you and who is bewitching you. Deal with the witchcraft. That who is that I'm seeing? You tell me. Don't ask me. You are the one seeing. Who is that I'm seeing on this left hand, on this right hand, this next door to your door, and your house is just by itself alone? Please, I'm not despising, but we really need seriously, we need these gifts to work.
Yes.
With these gifts in operation, we can tell, we can give knowledge of things before they happen. And people go and check, and they say, truly, there was an ID here. So you may find somebody around there saying they are operating by the gift of the word of knowledge, and our policemen have died. What is that gift for? What is that word for? And when it happens, they're, oh, and the Lord had shown me, keep quiet. Just keep quiet. The Lord had shown you, what did you do? You wait until things have happened? And the Lord had shown me, why did you keep quiet with it? Let's continue keeping quiet. Because by you telling us the Lord had shown you, it doesn't help. If he showed you, you should have said it before it happens, so that we take precautions. It would have been a word of wisdom. Okay. So, it is an insight into things freely given, the gifts that have been given, and the truth that exists. You are able to see into them. You are able to receive the mind and the thoughts of God concerning a particular situation, and you speak it forth as the Spirit of God gives you utterance. He inspires your utterances. You share. This gift shares the truth This gift shares the truth the Spirit wishes to declare. So it is not just what is written, what has already happened, but the new things that the Spirit of God wishes to declare, wishes to speak for. A quick example. The prophet, was he called Agabus? Prophet Agabus. He just speaks a belt and speaks the person. Whose belt is this? The way I have tied myself will be tied in Jerusalem. And the belt belonged to who? To Paul. He was giving a word of knowledge at that moment. That Paul, he didn't give direction. He didn't say, don't go. And he didn't say, stay here. He just gave the word. No direction, no point of action. Just sharing. Sharing what the Spirit wishes to declare. Sharing what the Spirit wishes to declare. He just took a belt, tied himself, which may have been declared as a prophetic action. As we will see, even the word of knowledge, when it is being spoken, it borders prophecy. The Spirit of God, at that particular occasion, wanted to speak concerning what was Paul and the rest of the people are fasting and praying, and the Spirit just speaks, separate for me, for Paul and Barnabas. And somebody is inspired, and he speaks that word. It is known, it operates, and it is known, it's understood, and Paul and Barnabas, the hands are laid on them, and they are released to go. And they go benefiting the body of Christ, planting churches and speaking the word of God. Bari yetu, Mungu atusaidie. In most of the cases that we see in the Bible, the word of knowledge does not give a point of action. It is the word of wisdom that gives a point of action. That says what should be done in order for that situation to be handled, in order for that situation to be averted, that danger to be averted. So it, word of wisdom builds on word of knowledge. You must have known or have heard or have seen in the Spirit before you declare and then give the point of action. Like what Elisha says. He gives a word of knowledge concerning what was going to happen, and then he gives the directives. Let the king not pass that way. He says what the Spirit wants to say concerning the occasion, and then he gives precaution, warning. Word of wisdom and word of knowledge, they move so closely, but they are different. That's why we started by differentiating. If you don't draw a line, you may think it's just one and the same thing. But wisdom builds on knowledge. Wisdom builds on knowledge. The word of knowledge is basically a twofold word. Word of knowledge is basically a twofold word. Understanding. What we say, gnosis, understanding, or gnosis in Greek. So this gives you the insight. You receive the insight. You receive the understanding. You are able to clearly understand. So it gives us understanding, gnosis, of God himself. This is the first word, understanding of God himself And the second word, or the second part of word of knowledge, is happenings of life. You do not only understand about God, you also understand happenings of life. So the word of knowledge is twofold. Onefold is understanding God himself. And the second one is understanding the happenings of life. But many times we concentrate on the happenings of life. You did not eat in the morning. You did not take breakfast in the morning. That is also common knowledge. Maybe it was too early for, if you ask, you, probabilities are there that majority of us did not take breakfast in the morning. Oh, I see somebody who did not take breakfast in the morning. 50 people will stand up. That is not somebody. Those are people. The Lord will help us. So, happenings. So we have the understanding of God himself, and we have the understanding of life, happenings in life. So, understanding of God himself, we have this scripture, Ephesians chapter 1, verse 17 to 19, understanding of God himself. The word of knowledge gives you understanding of God himself. And it also gives you understanding of happenings in life. But we are dealing with the number one, understanding of God himself. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 17 to 19. For I always pray to God. Then I pray to the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, that he may grant you a spirit of wisdom and revelation of insight into mysteries and secrets in the deep and intimate knowledge of him. King James Version is simple. King James Version does not go that deep. The King James Version of Ephesians 1:17, King James Version, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give to you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, that you may be able to understand God. And how will you be able to understand God himself? It is by the revelation given to you. Given to you as you apply that revelation in your life. You will walk in the knowledge of God himself. And it's through the revelation of the truth that now we know how to walk with God. We know how to walk with God. Initially, you did not know, but one day you are told, God hates this. God hates this. God loves this. God loves this. If you are to walk with God, live this. Do this. Now, when you live that and you do this, you're walking in the knowledge of God. God himself. Because of the knowledge that you have applied. Wisdom. Wapendwa, tuko pamoja. Naenda pole pole. Once we understand how these gifts work, the way you feel so bad when these gifts are misused, it is because you have this gift. That's why you feel so bad when it is misused, because you know how it is supposed to be used properly. How do you know how it's supposed to be used well if you don't have it? That driver is driving so badly. It's because you know how to drive. If you don't know how to drive, whether they are driving this way or they are driving the other way, you don't know. But if you know how to drive, you'll say, that driver is not driving well. You are behind them and you can say, no, this is a learner. The way this person is driving, this person is drunk. How do you know? It is because you know, you have the skill. And you know, somebody who is skilled when they are driving, the vehicle will not go this side, leave the line, and then get into this line, and then move, and then get... Somebody else who does not know anything about driving. And where especially there are no lines on the road, they don't know. But you will know because you have the skill. The reason why you feel so bad when the gift of the word of knowledge is misused is because you have the gift of the word of knowledge. You know how it is supposed to be used well. That is the test. When you see things happening and say, ah no, hapo wangefanya hivi, wafanye hivi, wafanye hivi, wafanye hivi. It is because you have the wisdom. That's why you know what should have been done. But some of us, we know how players should kick the ball and score and ange mchenga, ange. But if you are put in the field, don't do what you are said they should do. Unaenda kupiga mpira, mguu inapita juu, mpira inarudi nyuma, inakupita chini ya mguu na anguka. But you are a good coach when you are. Sometimes and all the times, you will be able, and we will be able to detect what God has deposited in us when we see the way the thing is used in a wrong way. You will be able to discover. The reason why you know that you have an understanding of that gift. You have an understanding of how that gift should operate. If somebody can come here and say that they know God and they want to teach, they want to preach, and you're seated there and they start teaching things and you start saying, no, that's not what the Bible says about God. That's not what the Bible says about God. Why do you notice? It is because you know what the Bible says about God. You have an understanding. So Paul is praying for the believers in Ephesus, the church in Ephesus, that they may know God himself. And having understanding of God and knowing what God requires of them, they will be able to apply. And when they apply, it becomes wisdom. So they receive what? Many times, where you find wisdom, you'll find knowledge. Where you find knowledge, you'll find wisdom. Because they go hand in hand, but they are different. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 18. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 18. And also write Ephesians chapter 1, verse 13. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 13. I think we'll stop there and then we'll continue, God willing, coming week with an understanding of the happenings of life. First Peter, 2 Peter 3:18, but grow in the grace, undeserved favor, spiritual strength, spiritual gifts, and recognition and knowledge and understanding of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. What are we supposed to do? We are not just supposed to understand, we are supposed to grow. The first verse, Ephesians 1:17, Paul was praying that people may receive understanding of God. Peter is praying that people will not only receive understanding, people will grow in understanding. We need to grow in the knowledge. We need to grow in the understanding. We do not just understand. We do not just receive the understanding. We need to grow in it. This is a progression of our verse. We need to grow in understanding. Second Peter. I was explaining. But grow in grace and deserve favor, spiritual strength, or gifts, and recognition and knowledge and understanding of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the Messiah. To him be glory, honor, majesty, and splendor, both now and to the day of eternity. Amen. So be it. So we need to grow. That's why we are saying we should not just operate in the superficial one, which is the second one, we will deal with it, where we understand the happenings of life. We need this one. Because the happenings of life, you may know, and somebody's problem may be sorted, but we need to continually know what God has said, what God is saying. We need to continually grow in God, in the things and in the knowledge of God. So that is where we should lay emphasis on. That's where we should lay emphasis on. We need to grow. Ephesians 4:13. That it might develop until we all. So we knew, we are growing, we have developed. Development is not just a company. It is several companies. When we say, hey, brother, you are established. You are established. You are a businessman who is established. It is not just one shop, one outlet. You have several outlets that have taken the economy. That it might grow until we all attain oneness in the faith and in the comprehension, that is understanding, of the full and accurate knowledge of the Son of God. That we might arrive at really mature manhood, the completeness of the personality, which is nothing less than the standard height of Christ's own perfection. The measure of the stature of the fullness of the Christ and the completeness found in him. The first one, Ephesians 1:17, talks about what? You get that understanding, that you may understand. The Greek word is, Aido. Aido. The knowledge or understanding that you're supposed to gain from there, the knowledge of God that you're supposed to gain from this verse, is known as Aido. E-I-D-O. Simple. Then after you get that knowledge, you do not remain there. You are supposed to grow in that knowledge. You're supposed to grow after you understand God. You're supposed to grow in understanding of him. The word G-I-N-O-S-E-I in 2 Peter chapter 3 verse 18. That is the knowledge that you are receiving of God. Ginose. That is the knowledge that you are receiving of God. It's the growing knowledge. It is not just, oh, I know. It is knowing and continuing to know. It is understanding and continuing to understand. You grow in the understanding. You grow in the knowledge. And lastly, it is where now you have grown. You have now grown in the knowledge of Christ. Ephesians 4:13, you have grown. You have attained the measure. You have reached oneness. Huh? So we need, there is still some distance to be covered. You reach to this level. And this is why the gifts, the fivefold ministries, the governmental gifts or the governmental ministries have been given to the body of Jesus Christ, that it might develop, that the church might develop. And believers get to this level where we all attain oneness in the faith. And in the understanding of the full and accurate knowledge of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. That when we stand to speak or teach about Jesus Christ, we are accurate. We are accurate. We don't say things and tomorrow you realize, oh, what I said yesterday, it is not that now. No, when you stand to speak, you are speaking accuracy. Accuracy, you know. You have grown and developed a knowledge. That when you stand to speak, you speak accuracy. You speak accurately. Even in the word of knowledge, we should desire, when we are speaking about the happenings of life, we should desire accuracy. We should desire. And for that accuracy to come, you must be very patient. Very patient. If you are not patient with that gift, you will hear one word and God was to continue saying other things. You run with one word and you leave the rest. The word you will give will not be accurate, because there are other things. The thoughts of God that were flowing have not reached conclusion. We really need to grow. We really need to grow. You don't just hear God calling you and you come and tell us God has called you. Then we ask you, what did he tell you? No, he has just called me. To do what? I don't know, but he has called me. Wait. He has called you. Wait for him to tell you what he has called you for, what he has called you to do, where he has called you to do it, when he has called you to do it, and how he has called you to do it. Many of us, we only run with a call. I've been called. For what? I don't know, but I've been called. You should have sat there and listened, Father. When you're working with God, please don't be in a hurry. Don't be in a hurry. Don't be in a hurry. He may give one word today. Write it. He may give the next word tomorrow. Write it. He may give the next word after next week. Write it. When you read the complete sentence, you'll be able to understand. But sometimes we just run with one word. and we shut our ears to hear the next word, we will not grow. Receive knowledge, grow in knowledge until you develop, until you mature, until you come to completeness, until you come to that height that was required. Some of us are no longer growing tall. You have reached the height that was required of you, that was set for you. So you can either go sideways or go inward. But up, no, you have reached the height. Physically, I'm talking about physical. You will not grow taller than me. I'm not talking about children, I'm talking about us. I will not grow taller than where I am. If I do, it will be an abnormality. So you are high. Spiritually also, we should. Children are born, they grow, they keep growing until they reach maturity. Spiritually, we should receive knowledge, grow in knowledge until we reach maturity, where we are supposed to attain. That when you start to speak about Christ, you speak with accuracy. You don't guess. And when somebody comes to challenge, you are able to handle the challenge. We need to grow. We need to grow. Receive that knowledge. We are talking about knowledge in the first part of the word, that is understanding. Gnosis. You need to understand God. You need to grow in understanding of God. You need to reach, so that you can reach in a place where, when you speak about the things of God, when you speak about the thoughts of God, when you speak about the mind of God revealed to you through the utterances, you are accurate. And when you make a mistake, you'll be able to detect. Amen. Amen. The last words, I think I've given it. Have I? No. For Ephesians chapter 4, verse 13. Ephesians 4, 13. The word is epignosis. Epignosis. E-P-I. Epignosis. E-P-I-G-N-O-S-I-S. Epignosis. That is the precise, correct knowledge. Precise, correct knowledge. This is where the Lord desires us to be. When it comes to knowing, when it comes to receiving from the word of knowledge, we should grow to that level. Epignosis. Where we receive accurate knowledge. The rain is saying that the time has come for us to enter the sun.